Hello there, music lovers. Welcome back to the Woodshed. One of the number one questions I get is, hey bro, how do you get endorsed? How do I get an endorsement? What do I need to do to get endorsed? How did you get your signature models? How do you get signature model product? How do you get signature model pedals? All this kind of stuff. So what I decided to do was reach out to a good friend of mine named Travis Tingley. He used to be my artist rep over at Sur, and then he worked for a company that made transformers for amps, and then he is now residing over at Rev Amplification. Travis is a great guy. He's been doing artist relation for over 10 years. So if anybody's an expert on the subject matter, it's Travis. So sit back, hang out, and check out what Travis has to say, and hopefully this will enlighten you and give you some insight on how you can get an endorsement. Hello, music lovers. Welcome back to the Woodshed. We've got another episode this week with a lovely guest. The lovely guest is none other than Travis Tingley. Travis was, he's currently with Rev Amplifiers. There's a little Rev hanging out right there. And Travis and I met years and years ago. He was an artist relations at Sur Guitars. And obviously, I like stuff from that company a lot. It's good. So with that said, one of the topics that comes across, I think it's always floating around the industry in general, but it comes across my emails and messages and stuff is like, hey, bro, how to get endorsed? How do I get endorsed? What does it mean to be endorsed? How'd you get endorsed? All of this like constant, like same topic of endorsements. So instead of me trying to make an episode of the Woodshed talking about endorsements, I think that's kind of cheesy because obviously I'm going to have nepotism. I've got products that I've developed with companies like Sur and Wampler, so I'm going to have favoritism. The best way to not present that or to present that in like an honest fashion is to bring in a guest and just bounce these topics across a guy who has had a career in artist relations for the better part of a decade. So Travis, thank you for joining us.
Yeah, man. My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, that's it. The end. Thank you. Thank you very much. Travis, when you started working in artist relations versus now, mm-hmm. there's and the experience you've learned in between, what does it mean when you just think about the word endorsement or sponsorship or whatever that is? What does that mean to you?
Yeah, it's, I mean, you and I have talked about this a lot. It's a funny thing. It's something that I've talked a lot about with friends of mine who are both on both sides of it, like, you know, artists and then also people that do what I do. And, you know, I think that the whole sponsorship endorsement thing, obviously, it's an old concept that goes that predates, you know, guitar companies and stuff. I mean, you know, you've had celebrities endorsing products for years. And I think that's the original way that, you know, endorsements and sponsorships were done. But I think, you know, in the age of the internet, the whole concept has kind of gotten a little bit fuzzy, and I'll tell you what I mean. You know, originally it would be, oh, there's this great artist, Slash, for example. You know, he plays a Les Paul. Gibson comes to him, hey, you know, I see you're already playing our guitars, or maybe it's you know, we could use many examples, but maybe somebody's not even playing that instrument, like John Mayer with PRS. PRS pursues John Mayer and says, look, we can build you the guitar that you want. And we want you to endorse PRS products. We want you to endorse this new product that we're going to make because John Mayer is a brand, has a name, has a fan base, has a following that we want our guitars exposed to.
And right.
Right. That's the traditional way that kind of stuff works. And where I think, you know, your career in the beginning probably falls into the second category and where a lot of the changes happened with the age of the internet and just kind of where modern music is at is we're seeing it like the flip being or the script being flipped a little bit with this. So we're seeing now a lot of these companies, especially more boutique companies like Sur or, you know, now I'm working with Rev. And, you know, and it goes across the board with all my friends and colleagues at different companies where you've got up and coming aspiring artists who are looking to validate their careers by being associated with a brand. And that's a whole different conversation at that point. It's no longer the brand looking to an artist to endorse their product. These up and coming artists are now looking for essentially the opposite. They're looking for a brand to endorse them, to say, yes, this guy's good, almost as like a stamp of approval, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that's really it. Let's just recap that one more time so everybody kind of got what you were saying. There's two lanes, right? Lane one is the artist endorses the product. The product gets value because that artist plays it. Lane two is the manufacturer validating the artist to hopefully that artist hopefully get some exposure and stamp of approval within the industry.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's two lanes, right? Now I want to add, there's one more lane that kind of ties in. Maybe it's like a side road off of the second one. And that is something that I was specifically into even before you came to Sir, because originally I was working with Ed. When I came into Sir, I was a young pup. That kind of is the second one. But the most important thing was I could never have afforded a Sir guitar without some assistance from the company. Like, that would have never been in my ability. I was playing with Down From Up and we were beating up the pavement, you know, van and trailer style, opening for Seven Dust or whoever. And, you know, it was a thing where, like, you know, the age of the internet was really, really in an infancy. Like, we're talking like the end of the MySpace transitioning to the beginning of Facebook, when Facebook was still just a college thing, right? And that's the third way that, like, an artist maybe who couldn't afford a Bogner, right? Yeah. Maybe an artist from another country that had no way of getting that. Maybe there's a way to, but that ties into the gear specifically more than what you're talking about, which is like the image, the public image, right?
Yeah. Yeah. That's, I mean, you know, the way that I handle it at Rev and the way that I tried to handle it at Sir as well was, you know, you kind of break these people down into categories. There's generally like big buckets of where these guys fit. And it was really interesting, you know, becoming friends with you early on, you know, better part of 10 years ago when you and I first met, and you were still in the earlier stages of your career. You had your first record, Disconcerting Amalgam, was out, right?
Yeah. And the buckets can change. That's what you're getting at.
That's what I'm getting at is you were in, you know, more of a lower level artist role at that time, but
for sure. Like, my last name's not Landau or Clapton or Beck or something, you know.
Which is hilarious because, you know, I know and love Mike Landau and he's a hero of mine, and I know you love him too, but, you know, your name now is probably has more brand equity than somebody like him. Not to make a comparison, it's just it's to illustrate the point that you know I think you've done a lot of things right, and I know that this isn't here, I'm not here today to you know, pump your tires, but it has been really cool to watch you go from, you know, kind of the new kid on the block that's like, oh wow, this guy's really a hot picker, you know, to and then I also think through your loyalty to Sir and your willingness to kind of stick it out with one brand rather than jumping ship, which is a topic we should get into later, because there's a lot of guys who have reputations for going from this thing to that thing to this thing.
Pause that thought, because we're going to dig into that.
Okay, cool. Yeah, and so you've kind of risen up through the ranks where it's like you've got, you know, kind of what you might consider a lower tiered player who's you know, either playing full time or even might still be doing it part time, you know, has a day gig, but is being really serious about it and wants or needs some help from a brand to get a little bit of discount, maybe make some of the gear a little more affordable. And yeah. And I can speak for, you know, Rev and my experience at Sir is like, we wanted to help those guys out as much as we could, as long, you know, within reason. I mean, you can only do so much of that. But we tried to help those guys out as much as we could. And of course, the discounts aren't going to be as, you know, aggressive, that we can't, you know, be throwing out free guitars or free gears to everybody who wants some. But, you know, you try to give those guys a little bit of help whenever you can, because we would consider those like the working musicians. You know, those are the guys who are kind of like, you know, on the front lines, so to speak, you know, playing in bars, playing in clubs. You know, we want those guys to play our gear, and we want to support them. And then, you know, not to get too far into the weeds, but then there is the other consideration to that is we also want to support our dealer network, right? We've got stores all over the country that sell our-
and manufacturers, and scoping back, like not just Rev and Sir, but like manufacturers have stores all over the world.
You know? Exactly. Yeah.
Global and, market, you know?
Yeah. And at some point, you know, the argument, the counter argument to, you know, hooking up as many guys as you can who are on that kind of lower tier of player is, you know, you could at some point be doing that at the expense of a sale that maybe a local dealer might get, right? Because
right.
that might be that, you know, who are those customers that go into that dealer? Well, most of them are, you know, gigging on the weekend. I mean,
that's yeah, right.
there are some bedroom players that, well, I shouldn't say there are some, probably the majority are guys who are playing in their bedroom for as a hobby or for fun as a great, and that's amazing. But, you know, a big portion of those local dealer sales are probably going to the weekend warrior type musicians, you know, who are playing the gig on Saturday night, but then going back to work on Monday morning.
Yeah. And let's get into the really loaded question. I know this could easily be a 3-hour episode, but the loaded question is, how do you get endorsed? Right? Like when you, that's the thing that I get answered, and I'll take the wheel for a second. I get emailed that or DM'd it or whatever constantly. How did I get endorsement? You kind of lightly glazed over something. You said, well, your brand loyalty to the companies that you work with. Like this diesel I've had since I took out a loan from the bank, the loan against the car. I bought that Herbert. Now, when I started touring, diesel, it was kind of what you were talking about. Diesel found out I was playing their amps. As my brand grew, they were like, hey, what else do you need? You're going on some big tours. Do you need anything? I'm like, yeah, actually, I'm doing Europe. Can you just provide some amps, cabs for Europe? You know, I'd like to try the Hagen when that thing came out. You know, there was like, at that point, you're building a relationship, right? Okay. But the thing that I can't stress enough is I played the guitars and tried to do everything in my power to play the gear that let me play the best and be the best version of me that I could be. I wasn't trying to get an endorsement. I was trying to get the best tool for the job. I was a race car driver, and I wanted to race a Ferrari because I knew it could do what it needed to do to let me do what I needed to do, right? So originally, when coming up through the ranks, I was playing. There's a PRS that's like right here, that was one of the nicest guitar that I had when I turned, I want to say, 20 or 21. My mother got me that for my birthday, and it was like my family didn't have a lot. That was a major like tearful moment, you know what I mean? So when I bought this diesel and I took out that loan, I bought a couple of Anderson guitars. Like I had the title to my car from where I paid it off in high school, and I immediately took the title to the bank and bought gear against the value of the car. So my transition to Sir was because Anderson didn't build any 24 fret guitars, and I really love Tom and John. I mean, everyone who knows the industry knows that those guys are kind of bros or whatever, right? They do a really high quality of work. Fret work is kind of, you know, I mean, it's
John and Tom are widely regarded as, I mean, the best of the best.
Yeah.
And I, you know, I know I'm biased because I work for Sir, and you know, Anderson gets
play either one of those guitars from any model. It's like the fretwork's really great, and it's just consistent. So I was like, okay, I'm going to be trying to pursue this as a career. I want that. And John was offering, he was just starting to build the Modern. And it was like, okay, cool. I can get this fretwork with this thing and these features that I like, and this makes this guitar work. So that's how my journey started. I bought them. You know what I mean? Now, I couldn't have afforded that without a little bit of a discount, but it wasn't. I mean, I think I got it for like just a, you know, right at dealer, just a shade over dealer. It's like, I don't know. It wasn't much. It wasn't like, you know, wasn't like, here, have 5 free guitars. It wasn't that thing. Right. And through my growing of my career, I'll just try to condense the story as short as possible. Through growing my career, gigs got huge. Right. And the relationship grew because, like you said, the shift happened. We're like, okay, you were helping me. Now it's like, hey, man, I can get your guitar on Jimmy Kimmel. I can get on the ACMs. I can get it. Like, I can put it on some stuff, you know. And when guys approach me with that question, how do I get endorsed? I'm like, what do you want to play? If you have I say this all the time now, if you have the Infinity Gauntlet, and you could snap into reality the rig with the guitar and the pedals and the amps, that's where you go. And you figure out how to get that gear. You don't, it doesn't help your career to have, I'm just using the back line behind me. You got Bogner at a bigger discount than you could get the Mesa, but the Mesa is what you want to play. You need to play the Mesa. Like, in my opinion, because what's going to happen is you'll innately be loyal to the brand, not because of loyalty. You'll be loyal to the brand because that's what you want to play. Exactly. It's really easy to maintain brand loyalty when you're playing the gear that you like.
Right. Correct. I mean, you hit it. You hit it right on the head there. I mean, in a way, people that come to you and ask, how do I get sponsored or how do I get endorsed? It's kind of the wrong question to ask, right? You're focused on the wrong thing. You really shouldn't be, especially if you're still in the formative years of your career and you don't have a big fan base already and you don't have, you know, an established career and list of credits and all of that. Like, at that point, you should be asking the question that you were mentioning, which is what are the tools that are going to work the best for me and that I'm going to enjoy playing the most? And then work it from there. And you may run into a roadblock. Like, you might fall in love with a guitar or a brand that for whatever reason, you know, doesn't want to or is not able to work with you. And
yeah, they may not have the money. I mean, like, that's like saying, hey, we'd all like to have a 59 Les Paul, but we'd all have $350,000 to drop on it. Okay, exactly. So what's the next move?
Well, and also, you know, if you fall in love with a guitar that's being made by one guy, you know, making them in his garage in, you know, Duluth. He's probably not going to be able to.
Like a Grosh. Like, Grosh doesn't have, like, I don't think Tyler has an army of guys working for him. So if you fall in love with a company, a guitar from a manufacturer like that, it's automatically exponentially smaller than a PRS or a Schecter or even Sur, you know?
Sure, yeah. Sur's in an interesting, you know, in between of being the small boutique guy, but not quite, you know, as big as the PRS or the Fenders of the world. But yeah, I mean, and what that guy, be reasonable about what your expectation is, because the guy building guitars in his garage in Duluth isn't going to be able to give you a free guitar probably, because if he's building a guitar a month, you know, that's a huge chunk of his income that he would just be giving away for what, you know? And also, it's like, if he was to get a whole bunch more interest based on, like, let's just say you're John Mayer and you want a free guitar from the guy, all you're going to do is now just put his back order out into oblivion, right? Like, you're going to create a 10-year wait. And we all know companies like that, right? That are, you know, they've chosen to stay small, to keep production small, and that's cool. That's what they want to do. But yeah, then you're just into that situation. So
that's more common in the bluegrass world, really.
Right. Cause those
one guys, it's just like one and two guys.
Yeah. Yeah. It's
so because if you want a Dudenbossel mandolin, you're like 3 years out, no matter who you are, you know?
Yeah. I think of like Olsen guitars too. And some of these, you know, like super high end luthiers that are just, you know, it's basically them and maybe a couple of helpers at a shop doing it, which is cool. I mean, like,
and it's more like apprenticeship than helpers. You know what I mean? It's like people that are trying to work for him are trying to learn from that luthier.
Yeah. And he's trying to find the guy who's going to carry the torch after he retires. Right. So anyway, we're getting into the weeds here, but yeah, I think it's the wrong question. I think you need to focus on the gear that you love, that you're passionate about, and that makes you play your best. And then, second of all, you need to just focus on your career. I mean, you have to understand this, not to be like, you know, super business guy about it all. You know,
put the suit on, Travis. Let's hit me with.
But you know, it's a relationship, it's a business relationship, and in some way, it is transactional. And you have to be real honest with yourself about what are you bringing to the table.
In every way, it's real transactional. And I think a common thing that I see, and I'm going to use the term young player, not based on an age. I'm going to talk about it as like where you're at in your career.
Yeah.
Like greenhorn versus like, you know, age demographic thing. The common thing that I think might be a wrong step. Here's something that I'm trying to help folks. The whole reason this episode is to help folks. The wrong thing might be trying to falsely bolster up and posture what you do. Like, you're like, hey, man, I'm doing 78 shows this year. Don't say it like that if you're doing 78 shows, you know, at the same venue in your, you know, in your hometown of, you know, Des Moines. I don't know why I thought of that town, but just like any hometown, you're playing the same venue 78 times. That's fine and great and go play, but don't turn that into something that it's not. Like if I was doing that and I was in Des Moines, I had 78 gigs at the one place that allowed me to play, I would email Travis and be like, Travis, I think the world of this little rev amp. I've seen it. I've listened to the clips. I've listened to Sean play it. I think it's really awesome. I know that I'm not playing arenas. What can I do to get a discount? Because I really, this is a great, like coming at any business, again, being transparent, being honest, I'm trying not to answer for you as an artist rep, but I know that honesty would probably get you a lot farther than falsely bolstering what you think somebody wants to hear.
Yeah. I think it's important to remember that guys like me, people like me in my position, we get these emails all day, every day.
And all day, every day.
You're not going to fool us. Like it's very simple and very easy, you know, especially with the internet and Google to hop on there and take a look.
Take a look
and do a Google search and find them on social media, and you can validate the number. I mean, because those are the questions I always ask anyone up front anyway. I have a little templated email response that asks all the pertinent data, that matters to Rev, you know, or to any company, which is, you know, what is your social media footprint look like? How many followers do you have? What's your engagement like? Do you have a YouTube channel? If so, what's your subscriber count? What are your views? You know, all these kind of things. What do you play live? What size venues? How many dates a year?
Yeah, because you can have low social media numbers and be playing. Like, man, for years you used to hound me about my social media because I didn't do YouTube or any of that stuff. And you're like, man, you're literally playing the ACMs tonight. Why is this not everywhere?
And nobody knows.
Yeah. So it's like that's important too. Let's change the target of the audience real quick. Let's say you're a hired gun and you're doing, you know, 140 shows this year with a big country act, right? Don't get it twisted. You don't need 60,000 subscribers on Instagram. If you can say that sentence to a manufacturer, they're like, oh, so you're going to be opening for Tim McGraw 132 times? Yeah, let's talk about what guitar you're going to play. You know, it's like, it's like, what are you bringing to the table? And it can be a plethora of different things.
It really right? can. And I think the other interesting thing that we were already seeing the shift towards for several years before the pandemic, but the pandemic obviously accelerated it, just poured gasoline on the fire, which is, you know, manufacturers are starting to figure out that we don't typically see as big of an impact from a touring musician in terms of like, okay, I'm playing guitar for this other act and we're doing all these gigs, playing the Grand Ole Opry or you know, doing TV dates. Those are great, and we love that, and we love the exposure, especially if the gear is visible.
Oh yeah, that's a great point. Let's just interject that. Is the gear visible? It's not like pedals. People can't see the pedals from TV, right? But an amplifier, a half stack, you know, a guitar, these are visible items. So that changes the game too.
Yep. Yeah, and I've never worked for a company that has only ever manufactured pedals or pickups. I mean, that's a tough, you know, you really don't get any value from a live performance if you're that company. And oftentimes, even as an amp company, you know, backline situations are notoriously difficult, you know, and a lot of places don't want to have anything on the stage. And so
I've worked for those artists. No amps on stage. The end.
No amps on stage. They want it clean. They want to look, you know, like our friend Sean Tubbs was on the Carrie Underwood gig for years, and they had all kinds of elaborate stage shows. And oftentimes he had like literally zero, he didn't even have a pedal board on some of those things. Everything was programmed and, you know, was switching along with the set. So that's something to keep in mind. You know, if you're a live guy, you know, it's probably going to be hard to convince a pedal company or a pickup company to really endorse you or to, you know, work with you, because it's, you're not really bringing a whole lot of value. I hate to say it like that because it doesn't sound very nice, but it kind of is what it is.
Well, look at it this way too. It's different. Like, you're using the term live guy, like sideman for the famous person.
Correct. Yeah.
Versus being the famous person, Paul Gilbert. Paul Gilbert, people want to know what pickups Andy Timmons uses.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? It's like, oh, he's using that pickup. That's how you sound like Andy Timmons. Well, I got some other bad news. I've played his guitar. I sound nothing like Andy Timmons. Right. It's just like the end of the day.
Yeah. Being in the room, I mean, at Woodshed, man, being in the room with that sound was like,
with Timmons.
Oh my God.
You're just like, God, dude.
What is this? It's, yeah, is what heaven will sound like. But yeah, I mean, yeah, that's a good distinction. I'm not saying just anybody who plays live. I'm talking about the live side guy or the, you know, part of the touring band.
A great example would be someone who's playing for pop country, or the guy playing for Ariana Grande or Bruno Mars or something.
Correct.
Right? Yeah. Because you don't know that person, you know Bruno Mars.
Right. Like imagine, like, to use another friend of ours who we know and love, imagine if the only thing that Mateus Masato ever did was play with Tori Kelly. And I love Tori Kelly.
Oh yeah, everybody.
And okay, so he's played with Tori Kelly, Jesse J, and Bruno Mars. He did a little stint with Bruno Mars. If that was all Mateus did, then his value and his influence in the guitar community is way different than it is right now.
Right.
Right. Right.
So with that go ahead.
Well, I was going to say that leads me back to the point I was originally making, which is we've seen this huge shift away from live playing and also away from so much, you know, the rock star culture thing has really changed over the years. You don't have the same Jimmy Page, Jimi Hendrix, Eric Clapton, Jeff Beck. I mean, we still all love and admire those folks, but we don't have modern day representations of those types of players. The rock god type player who you want to have playing the Les Paul or
well, now it's so different because Wolfpack played Madison Square Gardens.
Correct.
Yeah. Brad Paisley is Jimmy Page.
Yep.
He's
John Mayer
is, yeah, Keith Urban. It's like when you say, because and I know somebody is going to be in the comments inevitably and start slagging on Keith Urban and Brad Paisley because they're pop country guys. Let me tell you what, I've been in the room with them and heard them play the guitar. It's terrifying. So just make sure you got your facts straight before you start slamming guys, because Keith Urban can go on the stage and play for an hour with literally no band and entertain an arena. It's the real deal. And his chops are great. I mean, it's like you said, the landscape's different. We still have those pillar artists. They're just not from the same mold of dragon suits and headbands.
Correct. And the market has changed. Whereas in the 70s and in the 80s, I mean, that your only connection to those artists was through magazines and watching the VHS, you know, tapes, and, you know, buying the concert tapes or listening to a cassette tape or a record or driving to go see them live.
The mythos, the legend, yeah, the mythology, all of that stuff was more of a thing, right?
And I feel like the market was way more focused on, you didn't have, you know, literally tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of guitar influencers on Instagram and YouTube like you do today. It was, you know, it was all that attention and like focus was on those rock stars of the time. You know, it was on Jimmy Page. It was on, you know, the, you know, Eric Clapton and, you know, the big guitar gods.
Mm-hmm. You touched on something real quick. I'm going to try to keep the episode as condensed as possible, and I still want to get to the point of brand hopping and brand loyalty. But you touched on something just now that's really good, which was the idea that an artist doesn't have to be like the Clapton, the landscape thing that you were mentioning, right? Mm-hmm. So like today's landscape with 10,000 influencers, online, that ties into the validation thing that we mentioned earlier in the episode, in the way that with 10,000 influencers, with everybody that has a YouTube channel, someone with the little Bogner logo or the Sur logo or the Gibson logo or Rev logo in their watermark, it's like, oh, well, this guy's got to be somebody because I haven't heard of him, but this company says they're somebody. That landscape has shifted so much that it's hard to like maintain what is what and what's not. And I think this is something that's really important. You and I, you know, spent years with John. John has guys on his roster that he genuinely likes their playing.
Correct. Yeah.
And that's an interesting thing. Like
that's a thing that is another. Yeah. I mean,
Goes into a third element, really a third perspective where it's like, okay, what do you bring? What do they make? Okay. Now this company, this guy just has to like your playing. If he doesn't like your playing, it's just like, well, you might just be out of luck.
Right. Yeah.
You know,
not to give away the secret sauce, but those conversations do happen. You know, I mean,
those conversations are very real, and that's not a Sur thing. I guarantee you that's a Paul Reed Smith thing. That's an everybody thing. The other thing that everyone needs to realize that's watching this video is it is a very tiny little circle. If you think that John Sur doesn't know Paul Reed Smith, you're smoking crack. You know what I mean? Yeah. Sterling Ball knows Tom Anderson. These guys know each other. And that goes into the amp realm, the pedal realm. Everybody knows. Like, dude, you've worked for several different companies. And then you worked for a magnet company, too, right? As an interim thing.
Yeah, Transformers.
Yeah. So it's like everybody knows everybody. So now that is a perfect segue into, and this is, it's really tough because you and I know people that have a bit of a stigma in the industry, and we're going to have no name calling. We're going to be gentlemen, good gentlemen. But like, there is a plethora of guys that have a stigma now at this point, regardless of their success and their value to a company. Companies are gun shy because all they do is jump ship every other 8 months. So now go talk about that for a little bit.
All right.
Clarify that and talk about
it. Well, I will. And just to circle back to kind of put a little bit of a bow on the previous conversation was, when we're talking about, you know, whether or not a company likes your playing or the people in a company like your playing, it that conversation often isn't had in that way. A lot of times it's more about, does this artist fit with our brand? That's probably a better way to look at it, is like, you know, we cater to more blues and rock players, and this guy's like a speed metal guy. Well, maybe he doesn't fit with our brand super well. You know what I mean? So just to talk about that.
And that's not discouraging. That's the thing I think you're trying to say. Don't be discouraged if you're the guy that drives a monster truck and the Lamborghini company doesn't want to endorse you. Like, you don't do what they need, you know?
Yep. And it bears no judgment on your abilities or your skills. You know, and the other thing I was just, you know, kind of saying before we changed gears was, you know, the landscape of the artist relations game has changed so dramatically with the internet and online influencers, YouTube, Instagram. It's just a different game. And in some ways, you know, I hate to say it, but in some ways, somebody with a big follower count is more valuable in a way than the guy who's out touring with, you know, the big pop country act, because they have more engagement. They're more visible. They're in front of people with regularity, and they have a loyal fan base that is going to be, you know, paying attention to the gear they use, you know?
And at the end of the equation, if you're on the side of the artist, like you're you and you're trying to get an endorsement, you have to remember that you can't read people's minds. You don't know what a company's looking for. Right. And there is an exception to every single rule that Travis and I are talking about.
Yep.
In the comments, we're going to have
at
19 minutes and 10 seconds, there's an example here. It's like, of course, there's an example. And we're just like kind of the scoped out thing. So right. Now, let's. I want you to clarify what I was talking about with the island hopping, so to speak, and how that can really come back to bite you in the butt to where nobody wants to work with you.
Yeah, Yeah, I mean, we all know of artists who have had, you know, signature models with multiple companies, and
they change year after year,
and they kind of just never seem to land anywhere. And I, you know, I can't really speak to the psychology of that player, other than what I think that they didn't do is what we talked about in the beginning, which is find the tool that's right for their for the job that they're trying to do. Try to find the gear that they want to play, that they're inspired by. I think this is a great example of what happens when you don't put that first and you're just looking for the person who can do the most for you or throw you the most free gear, is that then you're trying to shoehorn yourself into playing this thing that maybe you don't really vibe with.
Yeah, you don't believe in.
You're trying to
make a quick buck, right? Like you're going for like, oh, well, I can make a quick buck here, quick buck there. After 4 years of this, and you've been through the mainstay of manufacturers, like now everybody knows your name. It's like, well,
yeah, you've kind of put yourself in a difficult position because you've got a reputation at this point. And you know, it's kind of like when you're buying something, you're making a big purchase, and rather than really buying the thing that you really want, you decide, you know what? I don't really want to spend the money. I'm just going to get this thing. It's not exactly what I'm looking for, but I think it'll do. You know, I can make it work.
I can save a little bit of money. I think it'll
yeah.
do.
Okay. And then down the road, you're like, man, this thing, like if it, you know, I've done it with a car before where it's like, what I really wanted was this thing, but I really don't want to go over, you know, this amount of payment a month or whatever, you know? And so it's like, I settle for the other thing, but then every day I get into that car, I go, I really wish it did this. I really wish it had the leather. I really wish I got the bigger engine, or I got the navigation I want. You know what I mean? And it's like, then that what could have been such a cool treat, you know, or a great addition to your life, added value, is now like kind of a source of bumming you out, negativity.
Yeah. Buy what you want. That's another thing, is like a lot of people think that, you know, when I started doing YouTube, I had this wall of amps behind me. Like, I didn't always have a wall of amps. Like, this is like over years of, it's like, but the point is like, I got the amps that I knew that I wanted to keep. Like, mm-hmm. That diesel's been with me for 11 years, you know?
Yeah, and that concept is, what I'm trying to relate it to is the whole, you know, finding the right partner, finding the right dance partner.
That's right.
To work with. And be ready to realize that maybe right now in your career isn't the right moment, but that doesn't mean that that's not the right company. Right.
Right. Yeah. You can get to the company when your timing is right. That's another thing. So like, I mean, there's some great examples. Go ahead.
You could have, well, I was just going to say, you could have very easily gone, you know, after your early interactions with Sir, you know, even before I was there. Yeah. You know, this company's, you know, they don't seem like they really get it. They don't really get what I'm doing. They don't really value me. And so I'm going to go try to find somebody. Maybe this company over here is offering me something a little bit more. I'm going to go with them because, you know, and that's, it's almost human nature, right? Because it's like, you want to go with the person that you feel like gets it, you know,
loves you the most. Yeah.
Yeah.
The thing is that we, you know, and we're all artists. Like, that's the thing, is like, we are of a certain DNA because we're a little bit more emotional, a little artsy, you know? And that ties into not just guys looking for endorsements. Like, let's take some big fish, right? People forget that John Petrucci was an Ibanez guy because he's had this, I would say, out of modern players, he has the most successful signature guitar.
I mean, it's certainly up there. I mean,
I have to say modern players, because it's like the Les Paul is a signature guitar and people forget that, you know?
Yeah, think of
like, I'm not talking about that, but like, look at John, what he built with Sterling, you know, and Ernie Ball. Like, okay, now flip the script. Paul Gilbert, Andy Timmons, Satriani, Vai, dude, Steve Vai, you know what I'm saying? Ibanez forever.
Yep.
When did was Vi doing Ibanez? I know he was doing it with Whitesnake. Was he doing Ibanez with David Lee Roth, or was that still like that parts thing?
I honestly
do remember.
I don't remember.
Somebody will tell us in the comments. I can't. I don't know off the top of my head. Okay, another great icon that went across the board, but I think did it tastefully. My hero Eddie Van Halen. Like, He worked with many manufacturers over the years, many, you know, but it never seemed like he was like island hopping. It never seemed like in 6 months Eddie Van Halen is playing something else. In 6 months Eddie Van Halen, it never came across that way because he would work on these guitars or amps. Dude, the PV line lasted forever. The Ernie Ball line lasted forever. Then he was doing the guitar with Peavy, and then when he finally circled back and did the Fender amps, it's like he played those. Everything that Ed did had like a big life cycle. You know what I mean?
And I think another important thing is like the vision. Like you could tell he had a vision for what he wanted, and that vision stayed consistent from company to company, fairly consistent.
That's right. That very consistent. Compare the Wolfgang to the Music Man.
Yeah, I mean it's essentially the same guitar, just in different iterations. And he was trying to, I think, in Ed's case, you know, it seemed like he was kind of just trying to find the right dance partner that could do what he needed them to do.
And ironically, you know where he landed in the twilight of his life was the Eddie Van Halen brand.
Yeah. Which
I'm super happy to see that Wolfie's going to drive that car, like personally take the reins. That's the right call.
Absolutely. I mean, keep it in the family. And I think the fact that he ended up with his own brand kind of speaks to the fact that he had this kind of unwavering commitment to whatever his vision was for that brand, for those instruments, for those amplifiers. And ultimately, he probably just went, you know what? Screw it. I'm just going to do it myself.
Yeah, I'm going to partner with somebody that'll build it, but it'll be my,
but it is gonna be my
Ed thing, right? Yeah. And that's ironic because it goes back to like, how did Ed get his start? He built his own stuff.
Yeah,
the irony of the full circleness is really, really good. And yeah. If there was enough hours in the day, who knows, he might have built every one of the amps and guitars himself if he could, you know, who knows. It's funny. Yeah, man, thanks for being on today. The thing that I think I'll close it and then I'll hand it over to you to close out is, when you're looking for an endorsement, play the thing that you want to play. If you can't afford that thing, approach the company. If it's not a good fit, don't write it off. You know what I mean? It may be something that you can grow into. Now I'm going to talk to the sidemen that are playing these big arenas and they don't have big social media. You have the tool. Yeah, you can make cool social media. It's so easy. You're right there to do it. So do that, right? And just increase your own value. Increase your own brand worth to what you do. Okay, now I'm going to talk to the guys that are the mega pros, right? You guys probably all have it all figured out by now. But any advice to mega pros? Man, you got to have a great relationship with the people. I mean, I tell you right now, as a guy who's not endorsed by Paul Reed Smith, I love Bevan Rich. Like, they rule. You know what I mean? It's a small industry. Sterling has always been so nice to me. I was standing there, John introduced me. Like, know the people, and that's what matters, right? Because if you're a big enough artist, a company will work with you to see your vision through. I'm super blessed. Hashtag blessed, right? Got a guitar that you were at Sir when that guitar came to fruition, you know, and there it sits right there. Right.
It is.
And so it was like, that wasn't a thing that was like being designed to sell units. That was this thing that I needed. I was like, this is for me. Fortunately, it's successful. Right. So it ends up being a win. So if you're on the top level, it still is so valid of a conversation that we're having. So you can learn all the perspectives of how it really works and just maintaining relationships. You know what I mean? Like, that's the thing that I think is the most valuable when you're at the John Mayer tier or the, you know, Steve Vai tier or whatever. Like, that's why do you think Vai's been with Ibanez forever? For literally ever. You know what I mean? Probably loves those guys.
Yeah.
You know?
Absolutely. I mean, it's the same. I mean, you know, you talk about having great relationships, and obviously you and I have stayed friends, even though I'm no longer at the company that we met. You know, I was at Sir when we met, and now I'm at Rev, and that's, you know, we still have a great relationship outside of any business dealing. And I think that's important because you want to be having these conversations with people who you have a relationship with, and that
and the industry is small.
Yeah. And you want to be dealing with somebody who knows you, who understands what you're trying to do. You don't want to constantly feel like you're having to pitch yourself to the company or try to explain it to some guy in a, you know, in a polo shirt who doesn't get it, you know, who would rather, you know, talk to you about golf clubs or something, you know?
You don't want to have the first date over and over again. Hey, I'm Andy. Like, oh, you know, my playing. It's like, dude, yeah, but I don't know. Like, I don't want to have the first date over and over again. Like, that's never fun.
Which was really cool because, you know, in the transition period at Sur, when I moved on and you know, Justin came in, Justin has, I think, done a really great job of continuing to, you know, be relational and he's a player himself and he understands what you're trying to do. And he and I had a great relationship before I left. So that continuity, I think, is important. And I'm real happy. I'm proud of the way that I transitioned out of that role and have maintained good relationships with all those people, because as you said, it is a very small industry. But you know, if you want me to have a couple of parting words for people, it would be find the gear. I'll echo what you said. Find the gear that you believe in that helps you to do the thing that you're trying to do, make the music that you're trying to make. Be okay with it not being the right time, right? It may not be, the timing has to line up. So be okay with that. And be authentic, be yourself. Don't try to overblow anything.
That goes into underestimating who you think's on the other side of the computer.
Right. Yeah.
Because the reality is, you're a great player. Justin toured with The Used. So, like, it's like you may be online. Like, I remember, Dave Ellison from Megadeth. He was a rep for a long time. Not a player, but like a rep. Like, he had a side gig, side hustle with a company as the A&R rep. And it's like, hey, man, just keep it in mind that you don't know who you're talking to, and they could be a terrifying guitarist. So don't go blowing smoke.
Yeah. You know what I mean? And just be honest about it. And there are opportunities that will still be available to you. Just be truthful about your situation and where you're at. And don't ever, you know, if you are a touring guy or, you know, whatever, just a working musician, don't be afraid to reach out. I mean, like what you were talking about with the relational side of things, you know, what you want to do is you want to start a dialogue with these people. You want to understand what is it that's important to this brand? Like, once you've done the first step, which is to decide, like, what's the horse I'm going to ride? You know, what are the guitars I want to play? What are the amps I want to play? And then start working towards that goal. Start talking to those people. Shoot them an email. Try to get hooked up with the artist person. Try to understand what they're doing. How can you be of value to them?
Yeah.
What are they looking for? And then you'll just start to build that relationship. And maybe you'll see them at NAMM, or you'll see them, you know, you can correspond with them online and just start to kind of like, you're like, it's all relationships, man. At the end of the day, like, I tell everybody, you know, I do artist relations and I do, you know, dealer sales for Rev. And, you know, at the end of the day, all I'm doing is I'm trading in relationships.
That's
know?
Right.
That's what it comes down to, man.
And it's like, you know, the most important thing you can do as a musician, guys, practice. Be a monster player, like, because yep. at the end of the decimal point, like, Guthrie Govan, you know what I'm saying? Like, Ian Thornley, Pete Thorne, Sean Tubbs, it ain't a joke. They can pick up any guitar and lay waste to the competition, you know what I mean? And so when you have developed your craft and your music and you know who you are, like, Plenty's a great example. When Plenty came onto the scene, he came onto the scene as if he had a 20-year career. And that's just like, I have practiced. I have done the work. Here is the art. And you think when he came out that there wasn't people wanting to do plugins with him instantly and signature models? Of course they were, because he had done the work. And there is no shortcut around that. There's not an email you can send. There's not a relationship that will be more valuable than when you hear Ian Thornley take the slide and do the thing. You're just like, well, that's why he's valuable, because that's awesome.
Yep, exactly. I mean, that's kind of a given to this whole conversation.
That is the given.
You might, you know, that's the prerequisite. That's like, you know, you're not even going to get into the college if you don't have that, if those skills aren't there, right? Like you need that before you even get into 101.
Yeah. Yeah. Do the work, man. Dude, it's so great to see you. This could have been a 7-hour episode and I would have been totally okay with it. But like for the sake of internet, you know, maybe we'll reconvene another time and do another one. For those that don't know, Travis is a fabulous guitar player. So feel free to shoot him a message and talk about Mike Landau till the cows come home. He'll gladly enjoy that. Thank you for being on, man. This was awesome. Thank you for being so open about a topic that I do not see discussed this open. You know, it's almost like this is like the Wizard of Oz thing with the behind the curtain stuff. So thank you for being so just like forthcoming on the whole topic and just being like, hey, yeah, here it is. I really appreciate that.
No, absolutely. My honor, and always a pleasure to get to hang with my brother Andy. Next time I'll drive out. We'll do it in person.
Yeah, I love it.
Once I get my vax.
Get your rabies shots, you know.
Yeah.
All right, man. Hang loose. Thank you, viewers. And you hang loose, and we'll wrap it up.
All right. Thanks.